who upset Aiken?
It's been kind of a wild bracket. There have been a lot of upsets today, but this is one of the more, at least somewhat expected matchups. Like, both these players are obviously very good qualified players for top eight. Like, something you would, it's not surprising to see this.
Right.
But yes, Aiken was the one who was upset in this bracket path. Upset in air quotes because Chicago is so strong right now.
Indeed. And so we're going to Battlefield, and the interesting thing to note, of course, a coward playing the hero. He is not playing Robin into this villager. It makes a lot of sense because, like, if your strongest power play, right, is Thoron or things like Arcfire, right, and that can get pocketed immediately, you want to switch to something a little bit less predictable. And, you know, if you can pick the most unpredictable character in the game, it's got to be Hero. So let's see what a coward's got to show here versus Panda Bear as he controls the stage, although immediately pocketed and died anyway.
So this plan has backfired, and now he has no magic power. Although I will say, outside of that one interaction, a coward has been working on Hero since the quarantine days. He was working on it online for a little while, played it for a number of weeks in a row. It has come out in bracket multiple times in the last few weeks, so...
Oh, certainly. This
is not just a random, like, hey, maybe this will work out because Robin Villager is not my favorite matchup pick. This is a, I think I can do this pick.
Right, I didn't mean to imply that this was a quote-unquote random pocket. I meant to imply that, like, he had a game plan with this Hero, but those two interactions just... It made it look a little bit of a sus game plan. I hate to say it, but you know what? That forward air will get the kill in, and there's a quick heal to even things out a little bit more here for a coward, so he's not as far behind as he was previously.
Yeah, a coward, definitely his general game plan is working. He wants some really heavy hits with the sword play. He's done a little bit of item game, but for the most part, I think it's A, for that exact reason, bounce is why he probably picked Hero to begin with in this matchup, and B, he's been very good with the A button so far.
And that's easier said than done for sure with the A button for the Hero player, right? Those moves are all so laggy. But the thing is, they're disjointed even though they are laggy, right? And that's going to be valuable versus Villager. Villager struggles with disjoints just historically as a character.
The more time has gone on, the more I've realized that Hero's moves aren't like so super laggy that it like is unplayable. They're just like laggy in the context of, I'd say, not a heavyweight. There's a lot of characters out there with big, heavy, sweeping moves.
Well, I just think of that frame 9 million back air, and I just want to cry.
It's frame 18, I think. Or
9 19. Million, like I said.
It's very high. But there are other moves that are also very high, and they just don't get talked about. And they're utilized just as much on some of the lower tiers.
Okay, I thought with the jump proc here that a coward could go even further off the stage and maybe push the issue on the side. But Panda Bear is now very far behind on this last stock. He has to turn this one around pretty quick. Okay, the zoom, not going to be answered. You kind of have to guess on the answer for zoom.
I have a prediction if Panda Bear does not complete the comeback in this game, and I will say it at the end of the game. But let's see what happens as the big lightning.
That's a great jump out of it, though.
I really like the way that this character suits a coward's playstyle as a Robin player. That forward air will not take the game, but very close. He's not afraid to go deep with some of like the B move interactions. Oh!
Yo!
That was saucy. That was very, very nasty. Nicely played. It's exactly what I mean by that offstage edge guarding capability. He didn't have to go too deep for that, but he made it look nasty. Here's my prediction.
All right, go on.
Panda might bust out Aegis.
Game two or just in general?
Right now.
Oh, okay.
Nailed it. First try.
I'll let you look really smart.
I will, thank you. I don't need to say anything else. This is all you now.
His Aegis is pretty good. I'm 2 weeks behind on ignitions, though, because I missed last week. I was on vacation. But the last week, or 2 weeks ago, we did see a little bit of Panda Aegis, and it looked really nice.
Yeah, he's definitely been practicing it a lot. He has not been afraid to bust it out in bracket. I don't think he wants to make a permanent character switch, but he needs a secondary. A lot of the top players in Ultimate have kind of decided that solo maining's for the birds, unless you're playing like the uber best character in the game, which there isn't really a definitive one.
Pikachu, like ESAM's Pikachu.
Yeah, Pikachu and Joker, basically. Some Palu players, but even then, like, a lot of those players will wind up with secondaries in a lot of situations.
Well, the thing is, right, even these players who were traditionally solo mains for so long in Smash 4, even going back to, like, Brawl, these players, they've been playing these characters for so long, and then this game has, like, 85 characters in it, and they keep introducing really fun characters that are just fun to learn. And so maybe they aren't going to be, like, reflecting the best matchup spread for you personally. Like, if you go down and, like, quantify it, but at least you have fun playing the character and you want to have them in the back pocket. Ooh, that Blazing Edge off the stage is really scary for Hero to sneak by.
You know, in a lot of cases, I agree. Although I do think that...
Oh, Thwack, baby!
Thwack over 100%, not too surprising in my head.
Still hype.
Still
hype.
Hype's a word. F-Smash from Pyra. Equally as hype as the Thwack. That's what I will say. I do think that Aegis complements Villager's bad matchup spread quite well.
That's possible. I mean, you're still going to have to struggle with rats and things like that. I feel like rats are always the issue. Like, anytime someone's like, does this character cover my bad matchups? Like, do they deal with rats? No, but no one deals with rats. Unless it's like Game & Watch, so well, like, what can you do about it? Oh, that's a snooze! And he's out of here. I don't know why I turned into a New Jersey person.
I don't either. Please
New
turn.
New Jersian. What do you even call that?
I don't know. Okay. Please turn back immediately. That's what I'll call that. Well,
welcome back to Pizza Land, Chicago.
I don't know what's happening anymore. I'm just going to leave this to you.
Well, he witch-timed past the up air and got the...
Got murdered for
the
it.
The DLC move of down air. That was 9 million feet away.
That's a pretty good move.
Still spiked. All right, the Lightning Buster just to cover the roll. I feel like that might be a Yoshi's story trick where he like faded back and then Lightning Bustered and would cover more things than otherwise.
Could have been. Slopes help with that. Going for the double down air. That's a trick that really just does not work nearly as well, I feel like, on good players. Like the down air and then they'll either get up immediately or like wait for you to jump and then roll the other way. It's hard to get hit a double Pyra down air nowadays.
Well, Panda's got tricks there. You saw all those Blazing Edge of footstools. But that was an unfortunately timed swap, and I really don't think he's going to make it back. Quick 2-0 for a coward. That's a winner side set, right? Is this not a best of five?
This is a best of five.
Okay.
That's 2-0 lead for a coward. Panda already in the chair saying, run it back, run it back.
For some reason, I thought top four was only best of five.
Top six.
Okay, top six.
So we're probably best of five to the end.
Right.
For stream setups. For stream matches. Sorry, words are hard. All right, game three, Yoshi's Story. Panda did well in the later sections of the game. It looked like he just had to warm up to his character and already looking very strong right now in the beginning of this game three, except now he's at 76. What do I know?
So that's the thing with Mithra, right? Is it's the exact same problem that... Oh, okay, that was a great read on the forward smash on the platform, but not going to quite get the stock here. Well, let's see if he can finish it off here on the edge guard. Yep, that will get the job done. That's the thing with Mithra, is you cannot be in situations where you're trading. Like, you have excellent frame data, and you can push the advantage state so well with Mithra's frame data. But if you're trading at any point, you're going to just lose right out. And that's what Hero proved there, even though he did lose the stock on the back end of the switch.
Oh, good DI to get out of that. And good DI to get out of the down air. Just caught at the end. That isn't true. I love Panda with a great recovery there. That down air up smash is not true if you're too far away on the down air. You can DI away.
But the history of Panda's use of this character is he's always been better with the Pyra than the Mithra. So it actually really isn't surprising to see him struggle in some of these in these scramble situations where he's in the advantage and then he just takes a bad trade with Mithra. Okay, that up tilt. Not exactly a trade, just kind of a clean anti-air.
What people forget about Panda Bear, and it's not something that maybe a lot of people just don't know, is that pre, like, Smash 4 days, when he was just a fresh-faced, very young teenager, he was a PM Fox. So he definitely knows how to play very fast characters.
I remember fighting his Fox at, like, his very first Smash 4 weekly.
Yes.
That was at the that bar in the city. I don't know what it was.
Mad River?
Yeah, it might have been Mad River. It was on the second floor.
Yo!
great parry on the thwack.
That's a flex. You're down 2-0, but I don't care. That's a flex.
And you might just stick with Pirate for the rest of this game.
Yeah, I'd actually be surprised if you didn't.
Because any stray hit, like Pirate's stray hits are so strong. This should cleanly kill. He could have pulled the trigger there in the corner, but...
No need to rush it. If he gets caught off stage and all of a sudden, you know, the opponent has a chance to run it back and he's just going to land. And I love that. That's just a thing that people have been falling for since quarantine started. Back air off the Angel platform. So many people get hit by that. It's crazy. And that will take game three for Panda. He is still alive in this best of five.
I am so bad at playing off the Angel platform. Like when I have my opponent on the Angel platform and then I'm sitting here like trying to avoid you.
Now here's the difficult part of this situation, this matchup. Now it's a counter pick fight. So Panda has to pick a character. Oh, he went back to Villager, see, out of the fear that if he stays Aegis, then a coward just busts out Robin, his main.
Right.
And then now you're in a world of pain. So now he got the win with Aegis, and that's great. But he doesn't want to go Aegis Robin. He's got to figure this out with Villager immediately.
Well, yes. He does have to figure out immediately, and then he has to keep it going for another game, because this has to go to game five if he wants to make it to Winners Finals, right? So we'll see. Villager obviously has game against what a coward is bringing here with the hero. We saw some pocket shenanigans in game one that were incredibly effective, but you do have to really respect the bounce.
I love that little combo from Panda there, where he extended it off of the dash attack.
Yo, nice snipe on the zoom.
All right, gets the F tilt. Zoom goes for the up air. I respect it for sure.
And now sneaking away, still holding the stage control. No bounce in sight, which means that Panda Bear should be comfortable here, but okay, really sneaky lightning there from a coward.
All right, here comes the tree and the bowling ball. He did that to fade the bowling ball. And I respect it, but just shorted it a little bit. And now Panda goes for the axe, knowing the bounce is out. I love the awareness, even though it didn't pan out. And he's got the jab going. He will keep this going as long as he possibly can.
Not even necessarily for the damage.
For the bounce time.
To linger out the bounce hitbox. Yes, exactly. All right, that'll mega kill. That wasn't even close.
What was it, like 120 pre-kaboom hit?
He was even lower than that. He must have been like 110.
Who would win? Kaboom or Bowser F Smash?
Okay, don't get hit by that. Okay, great stuff from Panda Bear.
Wow. Ooh. That's a punish if I've ever seen one.
Sneak. He's been good at just sneaking those bowling balls. I saw that in the comment set that he's finding bowling balls in really obscure places that you might not expect, like off of a tech chase. Where he got a spike hitbox. That's just a weird place to throw a bowling ball. Ooh, oh, you DI'd that? Excellent stuff. Okay, you're not going to DI the second one.
There's what I was talking about before. A coward with that really good offstage presence with Hero. Not afraid to reach down deep with those B moves and not allow you back to stage. Keeping this game within reach.
Well, the tricky part of this is that a coward's mana has been running super low. Okay, but he finds the bounce. That's the most important thing to spend your mana on. He can use the bounce to get some neutral wins and then get the mana back, right?
Plus, over time, like, bounce is basically 20 seconds of unlikely to get hit time.
Yeah. It's a huge neutral win. And now he's at 40-plus mana. He can find something sneaky like a snooze.
But wow!
What?
Panda's a genius. Not panicking, going straight to ledge. Timing it perfectly. That's a tough one. I think this now, because he made that play, it's his game to lose. Weak hit, it's a strong hit up air.
And yeah, this is going to be tough to recover from. Okay, good stuff from a coward, but he gets the roll read.
And here we go again. He has no mana, so there's nowhere to go. As Panda Bear takes the game, forcing game five. That snooze play to ledge, that's so scary how you have to weave. That's so difficult to do.
Yeah, so the aerial drift when you're in sleep, I feel like that's different than your character's normal aerial drift.
It really
so
is.
I don't know if it's because we're just focused on it in the panic moment or if it's an actual frame timing that's different. But it's hard to calculate that. Panda found the ledge, and that would have been stock for sure if he landed on the stage, or stock for sure if he just missed the ledge. He had one option there. He found the clutch, and then he won neutral from there out.
Nicely played. He's got to do it one more time, though. As good as he looked last game, A-Coward looked better the first two games of this set. And with Acceleradle early and some early damage, it still doesn't bode well. Panda's got an uphill climb, even if it's only one game.
Yep. All those issues that we described earlier where, like, Hero is out of mana, they do not apply on first stock. So you have to deal with all the shenanigans that Hero can bring to the table here and then win yourself that position. So let's see. Right now, Panda's at about, now he's almost at 100, but now that mana's gotten low, and he hasn't died for it, so that's a good start.
Mana got low, but it was excellent spacing early, as he did all he could there to make it back. He did the large tornado. And now A-Coward, with Panda at 103, is just looking for the back air kill. He was fishing for it for a second there. Gets the falling nair to get some mana back, as Panda can't seem to get too much going this game so far. A-Coward walling him out quite well. He goes for the sizzle. I'm surprised he pulled the trigger there. Oh, he was under the tree.
That was a really sneaky watering can from the platform. Like, Panda, he has his really typical watering can setups. That was not it.
All right,
he's
this
on
is
the stage.
He's got no mana. He can't make it back. Panda had a really crazy sequence there, and A-Coward just, there was nothing for him to be able to do. He was just kind of, he wound up getting stuck. He goes low. Panda with the low recovery. A-Coward now fishing a little bit, trying to finish the stock off, at least keep the game even. Sizzle was an inch away, the forward air an inch away.
Yeah, the stall from the Lloyd Rocket avoided the sizzle, but okay, F-Tilt on the neutral getup is gonna be good enough.
Oh, that scared me.
What?
Yeah, magnet hands are a real thing, and Hero has them in abundance. That may surprise you.
He looked so pineapple to me, but you know what?
I'm glad he wasn't. Right. I hate PS2 because of that. It should be PS1. That would never have even looked that bad. Reminder to all of you watching at home, PS1's the superior stage, and that's even true with bugs nowadays, but nobody wants to switch back.
You know I agree with you. Yeah. We live in the same house. We've had this conversation.
It was quite the nuanced and intellectual conversation. I will have all of you know.
If you want to call it that.
Nice down air from A-Coward trying to get something going. All right, he pulls the trigger on the F smash after the dash attack. Panda probably thought he was like in the clear just to fade in a little bit, and it cost him. Good little mind game there by A-Coward to take a stock. It was a good call.
And you get the bounce back up too. Oh, but that did not last very long.
Oh, he pocketed the fireball.
That comes out very fast. I don't know if it's necessarily frame one, but it's very fast.
This is scary. That fireball would just kill A-Coward, I think.
At zero?
It might. And he's not going to be at zero if he gets hit by it. Yeah, Panda went for it.
I don't think that would have killed.
It may have not killed, but it would have done like 80 damage.
It would have done a ton of damage. I agree with you. Ah! Oh, that would have shield poked. Good jump from Panda.
I don't know if a shield poke or broke, but either way.
Yes.
The move was woke. While we're rhyming. All right, last stock, game five. Kaboom, gonna even it out damage-wise.
But now, okay, that dash attack was really important for the mana game. Okay. Not even necessarily for the damage.
Now they're just throwing out haymakers, both of them haymakers. Nothing but pair of smash attacks, I believe, from each. Throws back the bang. I was worried about the shield pressure. Gets the berry into up smash, and that will take the game. Panda with a small pop-off as he completes the reverse 3-0.
I thought that pop-off would be big. Okay, yeah.
Yeah, there it is. There it is. There's the return pop-off.
The echo pop-off.
The boomerang pop-off, if you will. A-Coward played that game that set very, very well, but Panda able to just clutch it out with some really good Hero knowledge towards the end. He got some really good pockets in there. He played some good offstage game, and that chip damage, I think, wound up being the difference in the set.
Yeah, he managed the mana super well. I think that's the important thing, is like, if you can get Hero to zero mana, and, well, not necessarily zero mana, but if you can get him low on mana, and he hasn't killed you yet with some shenanigans, you're going to be in a good spot to seal out that stock first. And that advantage state adds up over time, and I think that it's tricky with Panda, because Panda, like, again, like, that bounce is so bad for Villager's neutral.
Yes.
But he eventually got it done slow and steady, won the race.